So yeah, welcome everyone to our next butterfly talk. Today is the turn of another Macaronesian talk, but this time it's more extended. It's just not one island, it's the archipelago. So yeah, today is the talk of Martin Beemers. He is from the Senckenberg German Entomological Institute. And yeah, he's a senior research scientist where his main field is in evolutionary biology and community ecology focused on butterflies. And he has a really great interest on Macaronesia Island since a long time ago, I think 30 years or something like that, Martin. So I think he can tell us a lot about the butterflies on the Canary Islands and Madeira. So thank you so much for being here today. And yeah, let's enjoy your talk. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Christina, for the nice introduction. Thank you also to Irma for introducing the Macaronesian island during the last talk. So it's nice to follow up on that. this talk has maybe a bit unusual perspective because I think the islands are unusual. They are not only nice tourist hotspots, but they are really interesting in evolutionary and ecological terms. And so I hope to demonstrate that in this talk. So actually, I think I could even say that in evolutionary terms, this is like the Hawaii in the European Hawaii. Yeah. So and not everybody is aware of that. So we have something really special there, really near our doorstep. And I hope that this will be also more appreciated, and it's also very important for conservation. Yeah, let's start. Here's for example one example why these islands are so important. This is from an atlas, distribution atlas of European butterflies, and these squares show the number of European rare endemic species. As you see, for example, in the Mediterranean, there's quite a lot, but in Central and Northern Europe, there's nothing. So these very local endemics are mostly in the Mediterranean, but here in the top left corner, you see this inlet for the Canary Islands and Madeira, and you see this is really the highest concentration of these species. So they are very local, and so we should have a close look also on their conservation. And on the other hand, if we look at this coincidence map showing the concentration of butterfly species which are protected by the Habitats Directive, you see the opposite thing. You see that there's more concentration in Central Europe, whereas there's nothing in the Macaronesian Islands. So none of the species is protected by the Habitats Directive. And this is just to show that they have often been neglected in Europe. Yeah, they are a bit out of the way, even the Spanish and the Portuguese, who which countries these islands belong, they have not really bothered much about these island species. So Christina mentioned that I've been working already for quite long, even since my student times. I did a paper which is still, I think the most current overview even really needs to be updated. It's from 95, and at that time, it was mostly on the distribution and what was known at that time. And of course, the knowledge has increased a lot in recent decades, especially regarding the molecular work which has been done during the last 20 years, and which has given interesting new information, which I will show. I also want to, if I give this talk, there's a lot of people who have helped in many ways with material and so on. Here's just some of them. I also want to mention this, the project we did together now in BCE, which came out of that too. So where also several people were involved. They are not listed there yet. So it's not only me, it's data from many different people. Well, so I guess most people know where these islands are, but just to demonstrate again that they are really they belong politically to Europe, but in biogeographically they are a bit away, close to the African coast, about a minimum of 100 kilometers from Morocco or Spanish Sahara. Madeira is even further away. And yeah, they are quite isolated and have never been connected to the continent because they are of volcanic origin. What is also often important, what is important to remember is that nowadays, yeah, the neighboring continental areas are deserted, but this was not always the case. So in former times, it was much wetter in northern Africa, and only during the Miocene, this desert has formed. So there were forests also around the Mediterranean in earlier times, and these were times when some of the species also managed to get there. This is often, it is important to keep that in mind. Here is an overview of the islands and their ages. You can see that usually, because it's a hot spot, the oldest islands are the eastern ones and the more flat ones, and the younger ones are, and more mountainous ones are in the west. So you see the age here between 1 million years for El Hierro and 23 million years for Fuerteventura. So that's the time when they were built. And also the number of butterfly species is more the other around. So the yeah, the bigger ones and the more mountainous ones have a higher number of butterfly species. Especially the highest number is on Tenerife. That's the biggest island, and it's also the highest island. Actually, the highest mountain of Spain is on Tenerife. And this is not even taking into account the part below the sea level. Yeah, so it's they are really high mountains there. And here is an example. This is a very, yeah, they have a special climate and also then special vegetation, which differs very much between the northern and the southern side because of the climate patterns. We have the trade winds, which produce clouds on the northern side and more rainfall. So we have forests, better developed forests on the northern side, but less so on the southern side. Laurel forest, especially, which is vegetation which only exists in this area in Europe, and nowhere else, is only found on the northern side where there's sufficient precipitation. And it's from 100 to maybe about 1,200 meters or so. And if you look at the distribution of these forests, which are also very important for the endemic butterflies, you see that they are only found in the mountainous islands, in the western islands, in the Canary Islands, especially La Palma, La Gomera, northern side of Tenerife and Gran Canaria. But this is the potential natural vegetation here on this map. So these forests have been strongly reduced, especially on Gran Canaria. The eastern islands are just too low to catch the clouds, so they are much drier and more desertic. So that's how it looks now. If you look at a satellite picture, and you will see that the forests are much more fragmented now, especially on Tenerife and Gran Canaria. And on the eastern islands, yeah, they are, it's mostly desert vegetation with a few areas in the central mountain range which are more has more vegetation there, like scrub vegetation. Madeira is still very much forested. It's one of the greenest islands, you could say, with quite a lot of laurel forest still in existence. Now I will go through a bit of through the butterfly diversity of these islands in a special way. So the idea is to go actually from the oldest to the youngest, so in the sequence of colonization of the islands. So the endemic ones come first, then native ones follow, which are not endemic, and at the end invasive species, which have partly only come during the last couple of years. So you have a bit of an idea how these islands were colonized. And I also show the relationship between, because I want to show also the genetic differentiation of the populations of the different islands. And here I use different colors. So if the color is the same, it means they are genetically, at least in mitochondrial DNA, they are identical. And if they differ, the colors, then they are differentiated. I also give some information on the ecology here on the slides and differentiation and also closely related species. So starting I'm starting with Leptotes, formerly Cyclerius webianus. This is the canary blue, which is quite widespread in the Canary Islands. And as you see, it's interesting that they are all differentiated, even though they are, have, until short time ago, they were not even subspecies names, but the populations on Tenerife and Gomera are identical. They are relatively old, and it's not really clear what the closest relative is, but there has been a recent paper on that. I'll show that later. What is interesting that on El Hierro, there are only some very old records, so more than 100 years ago. So apparently that population became extinct. And there is recent record, but it's a single record. And apparently the species is not there on this island. So it could show that there are only like temporary populations. And that specimen has even been analyzed and it was identical to the one from Gomera and La Palma. So it might be just a recent vagrant or so. Recently these the populations from these islands, which are genetically strongly differentiated, have been described as new subspecies, and a molecular phylogeny of the whole Leptotes group shows that the genus Cyclerius is actually not a valid genus, but it's part of the genus Leptotes, this species. And interestingly, the closest relatives apparently are in South America. This is, for example, Leptotes calanga is a species from the Andes in South America. So this was a bit of a surprise. On the other hand, there's one species, I showed that here before, this Cyclerius mandersi from Mauritius. There has not been a possibility to analyze this yet. It is almost extinct, it's extremely rare. So it's not 100% sure if this is closer, more closely related. This is still an open question. The other one there is Leptotes calanga. Yeah, so this is an interesting group which has many species which are only found on islands, actually. So it is apparently a group which is quite easy, well able to colonize offshore islands, but it's a very widespread group. The next species is one where we also have been working on in Madeira. There is Pararga xiphioides is the species on the Canary Islands, and Xiphia the one on Madeira. And you can see here, even though there is still no subspecies names for any of the different island populations, they are all differentiated. Yeah, all of them. The populations from the two bigger islands are more closely related than the ones from the western islands. And Xiphia is very distinct and it's a very old species. So it colonized the islands several million years ago. All those feed on grasses as caterpillars. And I will later say something about closely related species, Paragergeria, which is also probably the closest relative, which has recently also colonized Madeira. But I will talk about that later when we come to the invasive species. As you see, interestingly, the species did not exist on Tenerife until 2014, when somehow it managed to get there. And now it's very common everywhere on the island. So genetically, it's identical to the Tenerife island. So apparently, somehow there was material introduced from Tenerife. And this is also an example to show that we have not only invasive species newly on the islands, but we have also exchanges of material between islands. And this might be a problem also for certain island populations. And in this case, there was no one on Hierro, but we should be aware of transfer of material on and on, for example, caterpillars or pupa, whatever, between different islands in the archipelago. I talked to conservation authorities and they are aware of the problem, but there's no regulation, so everything can be freely transported between the islands. There's no regulation on that. The next one is a very conspicuous one, the canary brimstone. There are also, again, two species, one on the Canary Islands and one on Madeira. And also those populations are all differentiated. Although the data are still quite old and not very good, we need new data on that. Also the relationship to the next relative is not so clear. It might be one from Asia, but maybe it's also the Mediterranean one. So the current molecular trees are not really clear because the data are too sparse. But again, all are differentiated, and again, all of these species until now, yeah, this one and also the former one are mostly found in laurel forest, and this one especially, because this one feeds only on Rhamnus species, mainly Rhamnus glandulosa, which only mostly grows in laurel forest. Interestingly, this is an endemic to both also the archipelago of Canary Islands plus Madeira, and is only found here, but there is no differentiation at all between the islands. So this is probably because it's a very mobile species, and it has also been found flying between the islands, and even specimens have been found on the continent sometimes. The closest relative seems to be Vanessa indica in Asia, and this is very interesting. Yeah, as you can see, this is an old drawing from a paper by Leesmans, which shows that these areas are really far away. And so Canary Islands in the west, and then in the east, the Vanessa indica and some related species on the in the Asian islands. And in between these gray areas are desert zones where the species cannot occur, but which were probably much wetter in former times when the species managed to get there. So it phylogeny also shows that Vanessa vulcania is closely related to Vanessa indica, and yeah, the age is more than 2 million years, but it is certainly not identical, because formerly it was also sometimes assumed to be just a subspecies of Vanessa indica, but they are really well differentiated, as you can see here on this in this phylogeny. And another interesting group now, which is not found in the laurel forest, but it's mostly in succulent bush vegetation, and Barrancos, is this Hipparchia visi complex, which is found in all the western islands of Canary Islands, but not on Madeira. And all of them are very strongly differentiated. So that's very interesting. I think this group has the strongest differentiation between the different islands. And you also see, if you compare all these different species groups, that the patterns are not identical. So they are, the relationships are not always the same. Yeah, if you look at that, the closest relative is probably Hipparchia tefiki from Arabia. So there you also have a big gap in distribution between this group and the next relative. Now we come to species which are not so well differentiated, but this one was assumed to be just one species. Now it has been split into different species due to a strong difference also in the genetic distances, but in wing pattern they look very similar, so they have been usually at, thought to be the same. They are now more in semi-desert meadows and feed on Brassicaceae, and are not found in the western islands. They need more dry conditions. And the closest relative is usually Belemnia, which is found widespread in the Mediterranean islands. Yeah, a very interesting group is also the Canary large white. This is a very bit a weird thing. It is found on La Palma, Tenerife, and on Madeira is another species, Pyris wollastonio. It's thought to be another species, but it has a bit of intermediate wing patterns between Charanti, the Canary one, and continental Brassicae. This is a bit strange thing, and closest relative seems to be a Central Asian species, Pyris deota. And what is very strange here is that in mitochondrial DNA, the Madeiran one is more closely related to the one from Tenerife than the La Palma one is to the one from Tenerife. This is a bit weird, really, and calls for some explanations. The Wollastoni is difficult to analyze now because, unfortunately, it became extinct in the 1980s. That was already said by Irma during the last talk. We heard that. Yeah, so we have made really a very, many surveys done, and nothing has been found since then. There is not even a photo of the live specimen actually available, but there is a photo of the caterpillar, which looks very similar to the Brassicae from the continent, whereas the Charanti caterpillars look very distinct. So this is also a bit weird and doesn't really fit together. So I have some ideas that it might be due to some kind of hybridization in former times, but this can only be proved if we have better data from genomics. What is also interesting, the species is also endangered already. For example, on La Gomera, it became extinct in the 70s, and it was hardly even noticed that it disappeared there. It suddenly was gone and it was not known. Also the Madeira run, it was not really clear what happened, but there was an invasive species maybe involved in that story, which I talk about later. There was a short-term colony on La Gomera in 2013, but apparently only for 1 year, and then it disappeared again. That was probably also an introduction from Tenerife. But unfortunately, no material was collected, so we cannot analyze if it was genetically identical to the one from Tenerife or not. Probably it was. Unfortunately, we only have photos in this case, which shows that it's sometimes really important to also collect specimen to get a clue what's going on. This species mostly feeds on crumble. These are endemic Brassicaceae, but it's been more well known that it's feeding on Tropaeolum. That's an introduced species from South America. And on Madeira, the caterpillars were also found on cabbage, other Brassica species. And the original food plant is not even known. If you, here, this is a phylogeny of this group. And you see this bit strange thing that the Wollastoni is more closely related to the Tenerife one again. And then the Central Asian one is the sister group. Yeah, and finally, I think this is already the, we come to Timolecus Christi. There is very little differentiation, actually. Also, not all islands have been investigated, and they are quite similar also still to Timolecus Actaeon from the Mediterranean. And then finally, another Hipparcha, which is only found on Madeira, the Hipparcha madeirensis, which is not at all closely related to the Canary one, but most close to Hipparcha algerica from North Africa. It's even a different group of, also a subgenus of Hipparcha. So they have nothing to do with each other. That's a separate colonization, which is relatively recent, about 500,000 years ago. And if you have a look at an overview of these endemic species, we see in a colonization age, between quite recent times and almost six million years, mostly after the Messinian salinity crisis when the Mediterranean was desiccated. So most of them, they're colonized during the Pliocene and the Gelasian. And you can also see that the differentiation between the among the islands is very different, from zero in Vanessa vulcania, which is a very mobile species, 2, 4.5% in Hipparchia viscii. They also have very a bit different habitats on the different islands, and they are very local. So that's probably contributing to this differentiation. The habitat is mostly laurel forest for the older species. This is very interesting because this is different from most butterflies on the continent. This dependency on forest, whereas the younger ones are also found in more open habitats and open forests and also grasslands or even semi-deserts. Then I only shortly come to the species which are not endemic, but are widespread. So I have to go a bit faster to keep in time. One interesting one is the common blue, which actually was turned out not to be the common blue, but it's a different species and found in the eastern ones in Euchlocolonia, which is really identical to the continental ones. So the Polyomatis celina is turned out to be distributed also in North Africa, southern Spain, and some islands in the western Mediterranean. And the phylogeny has shown that it's not even a sister species. Yeah, it's quite far away from it, but it looks very similar. And it's differentiated. Also, the Canary Islands populations are slightly differentiated from the ones from Morocco, but not very much. That was actually an early result of my research, and later other authors have really shown the distribution of the species is quite interesting. There is some little hybridization in Spain, but otherwise they exclude each other in the Western Mediterranean, these two species. Yeah, some others which are quite well known, Maniola jutina, Aricia crama, Agnus pandora. If they are marked in green here in this case, it means there's genetic data and they are identical to the ones from the continent. So you see in most cases, at least some specimens have been analyzed, but not all, but they are all identical. So they are relatively young colonizers, some maybe even from early human times or even during the last couple of thousand years, and so not endemic. These ones, some of them here are well-known migrants, like the African monarch or the American painted lady, Vanessa virginiensis. Some more here, the small, Isoria latonia.
Egal, sprich einfach, ich weiß nicht, wie ich das mache.
Here again, Lampetus poeticus. Lysena flares is maybe a bit interesting because it was thought that Madeira has an endemic subspecies, Phleoides, but genetically they seem to be identical to the ones on the continent. So this is probably nothing really endemic. So these are all very mobile species. Lysena flares actually is the most widespread butterfly of all in Europe. Yeah, so it managed to get to practically all the islands. And then finally the seasonal migrants like the Red Admiral and the Painted Lady, which are found everywhere. And the Painted Lady is quite rare, mostly found in winter and is also breeding there over the winter. So some of the specimen we find in continental Europe might come from the Canary Islands and Madeira. So now that the next interesting group are the more recent colonizers. Pieris rape was always known from the Canary Islands, so it's not known when it managed to get there. It could have been by human influence, but it's not known. Maybe it was earlier already, genetically certainly identical. But on Madeira, it was a very recent colonizer. Only in the 70s it managed to get there. And interestingly, just a couple of years later, the Madeira large white disappeared. Yeah. So the idea is that, as Irma said already, it might have been due to some parasites or some diseases. It's not really clear. Certainly not direct competition. Even though Pieris rape was quite common at the beginning on Madeira, but now it's not so common anymore. Relatively early also came the American monarch, Danaus plexippus. Clearly, that's a species which could only colonize after humans came there because the food plant is not a native plant. It's Asclepias curassavica, it feeds on this milkweed only. So it's mostly found in gardens and parks. and it came relatively early, but some islands were only colonized quite late also in the 70s, like La Palma, Fuerteventura and Lanzarote, but the others already more than 100 years ago. And Hypolimnus mesippus is a very rare immigrant, which is found sporadically only. I have never seen it, so it seems to form only temporary populations and disappears again. It's a strange one. The male is very conspicuous, but the female looks very much like the African monarch. It's a mimic of the African monarch, so can easily be confused with that one. Also, Catopsilia florella is a very widespread migrant in Africa, but in Europe it's the only place where it occurs. Is in the Canary Islands. It colonized already in the 60s, then spread to further in the 70s, and the last island was El Hierro, colonized in the 90s. On Madeira, there was a colony a few years starting in 1999, but it disappeared again in 2003, and now it doesn't stay there anymore. So it also shows that colonizers can become extinct again. It's not known why it disappeared. Also the food plant is still there. It's also a garden plant or park plant, and it's found in coastal regions only. This one I was already mentioning, the speckled wood, Paraga agaria, which was somehow introduced to Madeira in the 60s, and has now, it was starting to replace the endemic one. So Paraga xiphia, here's an old distribution map, was distributed widely in Madeira and also still is actually. But now I noticed already during my first visits that the percentage of the invasive ones is in most places much higher than the endemic ones, which made me worry a bit. And there's also a paper in which recently was published, which shows that not only is the endemic one often now quite scarce in relation to the invasive one, but also over the years in these are certain transects which have been done so every couple of years again and again, and you see that the percentage is going down. So apparently Paraga xiphia is going down. Our recent survey showed now that at least there are some populations in the center which are still clean, and where, also in the center of the laurel forest, where there is no invasive ones, but in most places in the island you see the invasive one much more often. Still, the endemic one is there still in most places, but of course this is still only a couple of decades now. So on evolutionary terms, imagine this species is millions of years old. It's still unclear if this will lead to extinction or not. At the moment, it's still relatively common and easy to find, but I'm still worried that it might disappear, especially if the laurel forest is disturbed too much. Yeah, and then we come to the most recent colonizers, Azanus ubaldus, even though it's not really known, it's the oldest records is from the 80s. It might have been there already earlier. It's only found in coastal regions, and there are some very recent records on the other islands. It's not clear if they are still in existence. It's a more desert species, which is found in the Afrotropics and also in the Oriental region. Even the large white was found in the Canary Islands. Actually, it's a single record which I did in 1991. I found one specimen flying around there and also collected it, but apparently didn't manage to colonize the islands. It also shows that species sometimes appear on islands, but don't manage to colonize. But it can always happen again, of course, that they are introduced with cabbage, for example. And there are signs maybe they also hybridized with the native ones in between. Then the most recent ones, Leptotus pyritos, only came about 20 years ago, started in Fuerteventura, then Lanzarote, Madeira, La Gomera, Tenerife, Gran Canaria, La Palma, and finally El Hierro. This is the most remote and the last colonized one. So this is a bit worrisome because it's closely related to the endemic Leptotus webbianus, and it remains to be seen if there will be an interaction or any problem, because it's also a very generalist species which can be found everywhere. Currently, it's not so common yet, but in some areas, for example, on Madeira, it's already quite common now. But of course, there's no native species there. And finally, we have Cacyrus marshalli, that you know is not a European species at all. It's a South African one, which was introduced to Mallorca first in the 1980s. And it also spread into the Canary Islands, first to the eastern ones, and also Madeira. But in Madeira, it actually was only intercepted at customs, and it didn't colonize, so it was only found once. So the last island, just last year actually, it was found for the first time on El Hierro, and I was there a few years earlier, and I didn't find it, so it's really the most recent. But you can see, it's another example how quickly a species can colonize the islands, the different islands, if there's habitat and if the species managed to get to the archipelago. So I guess this is also something which happened in former times. So as a conclusion now, to finish up, I want to just mention again that most of the endemics, they originate from the Pliocene. Most of them from North Africa, which was much more humid until 3 million years ago, and rarely from America. That apparently an archipelago gets colonized quite quickly when a species gets there, at least this Canary Island archipelago. And despite this quick colonization, there is strong inter-island differentiation in most endemics. Yeah? So that means if a species is there, then there is differentiation. They have sometimes different habitats even. And so it's also important to conserve the differences among the islands. Most endemics depend on forests, which I think we should keep in mind, which is unusual for butterflies in Europe. And regarding the threats, apart from habitat destruction, as the laurel forests are very much being reduced, as I mentioned, it is also about invasive species, especially if it's close relatives. And this is a conservation concern, which is not really of a problem on the continent, but really is on islands. So we have to really look at the situation differently and take different precautions. Okay, thank you very much. Ah, in the back you see, by the way, again, the largest mountain, the Teide, with 3,718 meters exactly. That's also the largest mountain of Spain. Yeah, thank you very much. So I think I'm a bit over the time, but I hope it's still okay. Thank you.